Hey folks, this is a video response really to a person named Adam Fletcher, who is a director of the Freechild Project, and it's pretty much a youth voice movement. It's probably not going to interest too many people unless you're involved in youth activities, youth voice activities, youth service learning activities, those kinds of things. He had posted a paper, I think it was in 2004, called The Youth Voice Movement, A New Vision for the Future or a Lost Dream of the Past, and was asking for some comments on it. So I'm just going to go through. I made a bunch of notes on the paper about things that I was thinking about as I read through the document and took some notes. So I wanted to kind of go through this, but for those of you that are not familiar with youth voice, which I wasn't until I really got into this, what got me started in this was I was looking for some information on who is doing something in the social media realm that is encouraging child safety and child protection, online type protection, because we've seen in many cases that it's just not there. I'm beginning to understand that in many ways young people are very much capable of taking care of themselves online to some degree, but there needs to be some inherent mechanisms, I think, in any program or process or online social media activity to at least give them mechanisms to protect themselves. So I thought I would start out just talking a little bit about youth voice, and this is a document that Adam Fletcher wrote, 2006. It's called the Washington Youth Voice Handbook, and I'll find the link and put it hopefully over there wherever so you can see it. But it's the what, who, why, where, and when, and how youth voice happens, and I thought it was an excellent reference guide of sorts for people who don't quite understand what you mean when you say youth voice. And I thought it was a great resource. So he talks about what is youth voice. And the definition that he came up with the help of others, of course, was youth voice is the active, distinct, and concentrated ways young people represent themselves throughout society. And there was a lot of questions that I had when I first kind of talked to Adam via email or Twitter, actually, about, you know, this youth voice thing, because what are you saying? You know, you're just going to turn everything over to the kids and let them run the show, and that's not the purpose of youth voice. That's not the concept of youth voice. So I think there's some really good information in here about, you know, what are some of the effective tools for youth voice engagement? What are some of the important factors that you need to keep in mind? You know, the basic concept is that youth are part of our world and they have a voice. And I think the most important part of this is giving them a voice with the encouragement, mentorship, assistance of true youth voice advocate. So when we talk about youth voice, and this is out of Adam's book or manual here, youth voice must also have a purpose beyond just listening to young people. Years of experience and research have proven that in order to be effective, youth voice must have a purpose proven a place within a larger project or greater goal. And that means that youth voice cannot and should not be just about youth. This is very timely in terms of the new concept of crowdsourcing. I've just been listening to the new book, Crowdsourcing. And effectively, what we're talking about when we have a communal voice or a communal crowd is that the youth are part of that crowd, and it's not just that we're listening just to youth. They are part of the overall crowd that have incredible energy, resources, and intelligence that are all part of that conversation and should be part of that conversation. Because in the cycle of things that are going on in life, whether it's on the internet or in life or on this planet, we're going through metamorphoses and changes as we go through our lifespan, and the young people are coming up behind us, and it's a continual cycle of the young people coming behind the people that are doing things today. And if we're not engaging with the young people in conversation as these transitions occur, they're not going to be in a place to move effectively into directing and taking responsibility for all of the things that need to move forward. Another thing that he talks about in here is that young people can become organizers, philanthropists, educators, and lobbyists. Young people are becoming active members of historically adult groups, challenging adults to change with the times. Rather than resulting in this upside-down kingdom where, you know, the kids are in charge, youth voice fosters community engagement in its entirety. Two assumptions that he talks about, and then I'll move on to what I was going to talk about. The first assumption is that youth are always devious, scheming, and plotting to cause trouble to take over the world. And because of that, they must be controlled all the time. Control the youth voice. The second is that youth are always powerful, able, and ready to make change and take over the world. And because of that, they must be empowered all of the time. Both of those assumptions are wrong. So when Adam in here was talking, and these are some of the notes that I took, which I'm just going to rattle off, Adam, and talk about a little bit. You talk about youth voice and is youth voice dead, and I would tell you that youth voice is far from dead. We just may not be hearing it. There's two places that I know of that youth voice is very loud. And in the one case, it's because youth are smart. And when I talk about youth, I think for the purposes of discussion, too, it's good to have some definitions. Hence, one of the things Adam put in his handbook was that a child refers to the ages through age 11. Youth is the ages 12 to 20. And young people is everyone between birth and 25. So pretty much when we're talking about youth voice, it's pretty much the ages 12 to 20. Because that's primarily what we're focused on, although youth voice can be incorporated into activities with age-appropriate engagement of youth to get their voice, sometimes at a very young age. So, just some definitions to go along with what we're talking about. The biggest youth voice that we see in America today is in the marketplace. Youth today have more disposable income than we ever had in our day as youths. So they are driving market decisions. They are driving companies to make decisions about products, about which products get manufactured, about what features go into products. These are all driven by the youth voice through the use of their dollar. The other side of youth voice that we're probably not listening to is there was a 2004-2005 Pew study that was done on content creation by young people on the internet. And the assumption was that young people, because they've been brought up in this world of video games and television, were kind of passive consumers all the time. And what they discovered was far from that. So some 93% of teens use the internet, and more of them are treating it as a venue for social interaction. But they found that 64% of online teens, 12 to 17, had participated in one or more among a wide range of content creating activities on the internet, up from 57% in 2004. Interestingly enough, girls continue to dominate most elements of content creation. 35% of all teen girls blog, compared with 20% of online boys, And 54% of wired girls post photos online compared with 40% of boys. Male teens, however, do dominate one area, posting of video content online. Online boys are nearly twice as likely as online girls, 19 versus 10%, to have posted a video online where others could see it. So 39% of online teens share their own artistic creations online, such as artwork, photos, stories, or videos, up from 33% in 2004. 33% create or work on web pages or blogs for others, including for groups they belong to, friends, or school assignments. Basically, that's unchanged. 28% have created their own online journal or blog, up from 19% in 2004. 27% maintain their own personal web page, up from 22%. And 26% remix content they find online into their own creations, up from 19%. And the interesting thing about this, one of the things that I took away from the crowdsourcing book is many of these people that create content do so merely as being part of creating something that was part of a community effort. It's pretty amazing when you look at something like for perhaps the MySpace explosion, where the teens went in there and created their sometimes chaotic web page, personal pages, backgrounds, CSS and all that stuff, and started to share that information amongst each other so that other people could learn. They became educators. They also became supporters. They also helped other people create content. And this is the whole thing about crowdsourcing, that doing something with your spare cycles of time and resources and doing it for someone for no other reason than the recognition. Because even though I talked about the fact that young people are spending money and they are having their voice heard through money, to young people, it's not so much about money, especially when it comes to participating in content creation on the internet. Money's a factor, no doubt about it, but the bigger factor is credits. The bigger factor is getting credit for doing this cool thing, whatever it is, for being part of this cool project, for being part of this social activity, for being part of this mechanism of change. It's all about creds more than it is about money. So instead of just being passive consumers, young people are actually producing the content. Now, is all the content of value? No, we know that not all the content of value, not all the content of the adult stuff that is out there on the internet has value either. But the basic thing that you need to take away from that is young people today are creating content. They are having a conversation. We just probably aren't listening. I like the phrase radically inclusive democracy, sharing resources for social change. Young people today are having more of a voice with their money in terms of entrepreneurship and philanthropy. I mean, we are actually seeing cases where young people are cutting out the middleman between a service project that needs to be done and where do we get the money? We get the money from the crowd, which could very well be other young people, or they are able to tap in directly to resources to get their project done without having to go through traditional methods like banks and lending institutions. I think one of the biggest problems with youth voice in terms of what you're trying to accomplish, Adam, is, and this is my cynical opinion, I'll share with you, most of what is happening, particularly in social, political, business arenas, it's all about control and power and influence. Money is in there, but it's only within the context of, does it give me control, does it give me power, does it give me influence? So, if you have a truly innovative project or a shift that occurs, it's going to be an opposition to the status quo, and it's going to reduce or shift power bases, influence networks, and overall control. And it's almost a self-regulating organism. When you inject truly innovative concepts into the mainstream processes, whether it be education or politics or social engineering or city planning or whatever you're talking about, there's an inherent structure in place, and for the people that are doing that, it's about control and power and influence. And if you allow youth voice to come up with innovative concepts, you are upsetting the apple cart in terms of power, influence, and control. You talked about youth participation, self-learning, and it should be vigorous and necessary. And I think the other thing to come away from that is necessary, because young people are not stupid, and they're not going to engage in activities that don't really seem to be necessary just for the sake of doing them. And listening to me, it's almost a, you know, I'll listen to you, but I'm just listening to you because I want you to think that I'm listening to you, and I'll give you something to do, but it's not really necessary, but at least it'll make you feel like you're part of the project. I like the concept about the voice, which is not just youth, but the voice of a community keeps the community honest, urgent, and responsive. And I think those are things that are very much needed today: honesty, urgency, and responsiveness. And in today's world, these concepts really have to start becoming part of our thinking every day. When you amplify youth voice and promoting, and you start promoting youth service, you challenge the stereotypes of youth today. There's an interconnectedness of systems, and all of these systems that I talk about, particularly in the political world, in the educational world, the school system is probably one of the most political systems I've ever run into in my entire life. They are so, so ingrained in political structure of power, influence, and control that it's almost impossible to break away from that control and that influence and that power structure base, whatever it is. I mean, think tenure. So there's a lot of reinforcing cycles. There's a lot of dampening effects. One part of the organization may be looking for this positive feedback loop to make this thing grow, to make this thing happen, and yet on the other side of the coin is there are all the influences that want to keep the power, influence, and control where they are, and so there's going to be inherent dampening effects that are going to go on, and the end result is you're not going to have the growth that you're looking for. I'm convinced that relationships is the key, because we're talking about affirmation, recognition, and a sense of real accomplishment. And in a lot of the books that I'm reading today, I'm beginning to understand that it's almost a cosmic concept of we are, instead of we are what we eat, we are the relationships that we have. And it's all about relationships. And the other thing we need to keep in mind is that youth voice, youth involvement, and especially service learning projects, the reasons for being involved are as varied as the people that are involved in them. There's no real way to put your finger on, oh, I know exactly why this young person is involved in this project or is giving me their voice. Sometimes we don't have a clue. Social media is a huge percentage of youth relationships, and I would say youth voice. Social media is all about connecting and relationships. Goes back to what I was talking about in terms of relationships. So the youth voice is out there. We just might not be listening to it. Youth today have a lot of social pressures. There's global influence, worldview, and in some cases a lack of childhood for some kids that are out there. But realize that the youth of today are much more plugged into the whole social realization of what's going on in the world. The global influences around the world are having their impact on them, because they're not up here at the traditional media levels that you and I are, you know, the crowdsourcing book, they were talking about, you know, we're digital immigrants. You know, we've come into this digital world. These are the actual digital natives. They've grown up on this world. If you were to ask a young child today, what was the first time that you used the internet, it would be like asking them, when was the first time, do you remember the first time you ate food? Because it's always been there. There needs to be that awareness that you talked about, with a sense of urgency, passion, and energy. I mean, there's a lot of passion and energy in young people. Diversity is becoming less and less important in terms of color, gender, all that kind of stuff. Those lines are really beginning to blur in many ways because of this inter-world connectedness. The continued involvement issue is one that definitely needs to be considered, because I know a lot of people that get involved in social activities and reach that burnout phase pretty quickly, because they are totally overworked, overwhelmed, potentially underappreciated. So if we start with young people and get them into service learning projects, or start engaging them with Youth Voice, and they get active, and we don't support them, or we don't give them the necessary resources to be successful, or to help them make the entire project successful, then they're gonna burn out, and then they're gonna become much more cynical and much more difficult to engage as adults. Information is power. Methods and means is power. I can make this happen, so I have value and power and influence. We get a lot of adults that get involved in service projects because there's some inherent basic need that's being fulfilled for that individual, and it's not always altruistic or philanthropic. We've got people that they want to increase their influence and their power. We have people that are engaged in these activities because they're basically just token efforts to show compassion without really getting your hands dirty. A lot of self-seeking interests, financially, socially, power, influence, control. Some people get involved in, some adults get involved in these activities to assuage their own guilt for whatever reason. You rarely get true service orientation at the top. This is my feeling. It's generally buried deep in the passion of the hands, in the hands-on work. And so youth must learn to bridge that chasm, and often lack the social skills to do so. So there's a real deep chasm between the higher level service orientation that is, in my opinion, pretty minimal at the top. The real passion, the real core of the work is done from the hands, at the hands-on level. And in order to have youth voice be heard, part of that process is bridging that chasm. And young people just don't have the social skills always to do that. So that was my quick review of this document in terms of youth voice, Adam. I hope it helped a little bit. I like what I see in terms of what you're doing. I think the toughest challenge is to get over some of the stereotypes of the concept of youth voice, because when people hear youth voice, they think, we're just turning everything over to the kids and let them do it. No, of course that's not true. You don't hand your child the keys to a car when they turn 16 and they've never driven a car, and you hand them the keys and you say, here, figure it out. No, obviously there is adult mentorship and adult sponsorship, and there's an adult cooperation that goes along with, you know, integrating the youth voice just like every other voice that's in a community, making sure that you get the full noise, if you will, of all of these different packages that come together. The other thing that people have a problem with is that, you know, if we involve youth and we start bringing youth into the picture, they are going to be messy, and they're going to be noisy, and they're going to cause a lot of crap, and they're going to they're just going to upset the apple cart, and before you know it, we're going to have, like, chaos, right? We will not know what to do. A great quote from this Leadership in the New Science, Discovering Order in a Chaotic World. A lot of concepts in this book I really like. One of the concepts is that it is possible to have order in chaos. We don't like chaos as adults. It seems that the very experiences that these children seek are the ones that we avoid. Disequilibrium, novelty, loss of control, surprise. These make for a good playground, but for a dangerous life. We avoid these things so much that if an organization were to take the form of a teeter-totter, we'd brace it up on both ends, turning it into a stable plank. But why has equilibrium become such a prized goal in adult life? Why do we seek so earnestly after balance? Is change so fearsome that we'll do anything to avoid it? Equilibrium, a condition in which all acting influences are canceled by others, resulting in a stable, balanced, or unchanging system. Is that really what we want in our communities, in our society, in our world? A stable, balanced, unchanging system. Zero-sum game. There is no forward movement, backward movement. Nothing is happening. We are stable, and we are balanced, and we are unchanging, unwavering. Nothing will ever change. I think for those of us that have lived a year or two, we realize that everything changes all the time. And the youth voice, the value of the youth voice, is that they have the ability to not only deal with chaos and change, but embrace it, seek it out. They look to upset the apple cart, and sometimes it just makes smashed apples. But sometimes you get some really cool applesauce, and it's the kind of thing that moves us forward as a society and as humans. So that's my thoughts on youth voice. Adam, I hope it's of some value. I've got some other things I wanted to talk about, but I wanted to respond to you on that particular document and some of those other thoughts that I had.